This is the CACE International Show, and I'm your host, fikishac. We have as our guest tonight the man who made the marriage of Afro-Cuban music and jazz. His name is Mr. Mario Bauza. Mr. Bauza, I am so happy to have you as our guest on the show. What did you do in Cuba before you came to America?
Well, I was playing with the Havana Philharmonic Orchestra, but and then I didn't want to go to the popular music. So I came to New York. I had the opportunity to come to New York with Antonio Maria Romeo. That was the biggest dance song orchestra in Cuba, and I came here to record it.
Did you stay? Or you?
No, we stayed here 15 days, and I started listening to all this great band of Charlie Johnson, and Fletcher Henderson, and Paul Wyman, and I fell in love with jazz. I bought me a saxophone. I went back to Cuba. I said, I'd be back to live in this country.
So how long did you take to come back?
Well, I had to wait 2 years till I get 18, so I get a passport.
So you were 16 when you came here
in the 16 beginning? 16.
So when did you come to the United States?
Came back to 1930.
In 1930?
Came to live.
Now, if you add that up, people, he adds up to be how old? 80? One and a half.
Enough.
We'll be 82 years old pretty soon. You look wonderful.
Thank you.
Like I said, you look marvelous.
Thank you, thank you.
How did you meet Chick Webb? I mean, what was your involvement with Chick Webb?
I was working in the Savoy Ballroom with a band called the Missourians, and Chick Webb was a big band, the number one orchestra there. So there was opportunity. One of the trumpet players with Chick Webb was moving to Duke Ellington Orchestra, so he invited me to audition with his band, and I did it. And after a few rehearsals, he taught me how to play the jazz idiom.
So then what did he mean by, what do you mean when you said he taught you how to play in English?
I tell you why. See, you can be a legitimate musician, no matter how good you are, and you read music, yeah, but the expression, different expressions, is completely different.
So he taught you how to do the black expression.
Yeah, how the Negro express their jazz.
I see.
They didn't took me no much time. Very little time I catch up with it.
Now we know that Ella Fitzgerald really started her career singing with Chick Webb, but we also know that you were the one who really discovered Ella Fitzgerald.
No, I didn't discover.
Okay, what happened with that?
She was in the amateur contest in the Harlem Opera House.
Okay.
So now when I came to work in the morning to the first show in the Apollo Theater that was working, the fellow that worked backstage told me, Mario, it's a lady. They won the first prize yesterday. This is what you need in this band here. So I said, well, she come around and introduce it to me. So the lady came by, and I took it to the rehearsal room downstairs with the piano player, and I flipped. And I run to Chick. I said, Chick, I find my diamond in the rough. So who is it? I said, I can bring it to you. Bring the lady. So he looked at her, and you know, she was a young kid. Don't have a hell of an appearance. But she seemed wonderful. So she said, he said to me, what are we going to do with this? I said, well, we close here tomorrow. We got to play the proms in Yale University. Let's take it. We didn't prepare nothing. I said, don't worry. Let me worry about that. So we took that lady over there. And that was that.
And that was the beginning
that was
of
that.
Her.
From the
so
first
you were
night.
The one who introduced her to Chick Webb.
Well, yeah, indirectly.
And that was really the start of her career
getting big.
But you also played with Cab Calloway.
Yeah.
And there's a story about Dizzy and the Cab Band.
That
what
was
that
another story, see? Dizzy and myself was friends. when I was working with Chick Webb, we became to be a friend. He and Maya Davey and Charlie Chaffin, with all John Trumpet players. So he always said to me, how you get all those first class jobs and I don't get those jobs? I said, well, it's a two different position. You are a solos man, and they claim there's a whole lot of solos men around, and I'm just a fresh air man in the orchestra. So I said, but don't worry, someday you're gonna get there. So when I left Chick, I went with Earl Redman, and then I went with Cab Calloway. He wrote to me and said, you see, you got the best job in town. What happened now? I said, Dizzy, I'm gonna get you there, but you gotta do what I tell you to do. He said, what you want me to do? I said, I'm gonna send you there in my place, and you tell her when you get there about 10 minutes before the show, and tell her that I'm sick and I call you, and you work there. So he went there. I said, but limit yourself what you're playing. Don't play everything that you know, because they're too advanced for them, and they might don't. That's what the musician used to tell, criticize this. They say he was crazy. He played a whole lot of crazy stuff. And I used to say, no, this man is way advanced. This man gonna change the idiom with jazz. When I got back, about 3 days later, Cap said, what happened? I said, well, you know, we've been working so hard, Cab, I had a call, I had to take a rest, so I sent that man. That was the first thing that came to my head. So he looked at me, he said, man. A couple of days later, he said, hey, you want the boy in this band? I said, no, I don't want him. Hey. We need him in this band. So he said, send for him. And that's how he got him in there.
So now, what is Cu-bop?
Cu-bop. After I created the Afro-Cuban, when I introduced this to Chano Pozo.
Okay, now Chano Pozo was
the creator of Manteca. It was a writer and a conga player.
In Cuba?
Yeah, okay. And he came here with his wife and another fellow playing conga. There was a dance team. Mm. So I met that Chano. So when Dizzy came to me, he said, I got a chance to play a concert. I don't know what to play. I said, why don't you play my music? He said, yeah, but I don't know nothing about your rhythm. I said, but I got a man just came from Cuba, he's top. So I took to meet Chano, said, Chano, take your conga, play and sing some of your song to this. This is a flip on the head. So right away, they went to rehearsal, and the concert was a big success, and after that, I don't have to tell you, history is there.
Did he continue to work with Chano Pozo? Or?
Yeah, Chano Pozo was in the band about over a year until he got killed.
Oh, he got killed?
Yeah, he got killed.
I know we had Jane Cortez on our show, and she did a poem to Chano Pozo, but that was the first time I had ever heard of him.
Oh, yeah.
So it was quite interesting that
he was a hell of a writer, and a hell of a showman, and a hell of a conga player.
I mean, he got violently killed or killed in a car accident or something?
No, something happened.
Some mess, huh? Tell me about the Palladium, New York City's Palladium.
When the Palladium was created, it was a ballroom, just like the Roslyn and the Acadia. There were three ballrooms, one and the other, but the Palladium was the last one, and they couldn't compete with the Acadia and the Roslyn.
So now, is it the same Palladium that's there now on 14th Street?
No, there was a 53rd and Broadway.
Okay.
It's a big new building there. So the man that was manager there knew me when I was working with the color bands. So, being the Machito band was so popular with the Jewish train and all the white trade, we was working at the Concord Hotel in the mountain. Mm-hmm. So he came to see me and said, Mario, I need a favor from you. I said, what you want, Tommy? Tommy Morton. He said, I'm the manager of the Palladium Ballroom, and we got about 2 more weeks to close the place. We cannot compete with other ballrooms. So if you close here and level day and give me a couple of weeks, I'd be able to survive. All right, you have it. So I came to the Palladium and played. The first couple of nights was packed. Mm-hmm. All that clientele, Machito Orchestra, had it came there. But Sunday, they were very slow. I said, Tommy, what happened? He said, well, you know, on Sunday, your trade, your Jewish people, they read, stay home, reading the paper, look at the basketball game. I said, why don't you run? Well, it's something for the Latin people then. Latin people ain't gonna play downtown to dance. He said, well, Mario, you know, we're afraid about that because, I said, afraid about what? I said, they interest you. I said, man, what's the matter with that? The people used to go on the Savoy, black and white, everybody.
Now, what year was this in about? Huh? About what year was this?
The Palladium?
Yeah. What year are you
that
talking about now?
That was in the 50-something.
This in the 50s?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So they call a meeting, then they say, well, Mario, go ahead, let's try one Sunday. So I went uptown and got a hold of my compadre. He was a promoter over there in Latin town. I said, Federico, we got to run like a club. So give it a kind of mafia so that don't have every Jin Jong jumping in there. So he said, let's call it Bling Bling Club. Bling Bling was a tune that was very popular by Chano Pozo in those days that I used to play. Uh-huh. So I went to Chano, asking permission to use it. And he said, go ahead, Mario, go ahead. So we run it the first Sunday. They opened the door about 4 o'clock and about 5. You couldn't get no more people
what?
There. They closed Broadway.
Now, wait a minute. Was the Palladium just on Sundays? I mean, the Latin night was just Sundays?
Sunday.
Oh, it was just Sundays?
The first Sunday.
Oh, okay.
And then we run another Sunday. And then we went to Wednesday. And then we said, well, the only way I stay here, if you get rid of that American band, they had a society American band. Uh-huh. Because the people coming here now to dance
Latin.
Mambo, cha-cha-cha.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
So, and then I got another band, and then Marcelino Guerra, and then I told
Tito Puente.
I said, why don't you organize a little conjunto to play in the afternoon here? Because he was working at the Copacabana, said he bought a player with Martin. Mm. So, and then he organized a little group, and he come in there. So, they got rid of that jazz band, and then we're going into the 100% Latin music.
And that Palladium went for a long time, didn't it?
Palladium was like a Savoy was in Harlem.
Yeah. Now, what about the Savoy? You played the Savoy, too.
Savoy was the greatest ballroom ever since in the city of New York.
Really?
Every celebrity, every people from Europe, they visit New York, come to the Savoy ballroom.
It was big, too, right?
Big. And all the dancing was creating in there. They have this was secured, all that was created there. But
they played, like, jazz up at the Savoy,
oh,
right?
Oh, yeah. They played jazz, they played tango, they played waltz.
Did they play Latin up there?
And then I started and play something with Chick. We had about 2 numbers. Now and then we'd throw one of the numbers. It was yeah.
Now, you talked about cha-cha-cha a little, just a minute ago. Yeah. Now, is cha-cha-cha the rumba and the mumbo, does all that come out of Cuba?
Oh, everything is from Cuba. It's a different style of dances. The great thing about a Cuban, every movement and music that they created dances to go along with it.
Ah, okay.
So cha-cha-cha is different than the mambo. Mambo is different than the guaracha. Guaracha is different than the bolero. Bolero is different than the guaguancó.
I never heard of 2 of those.
Oh, there's so many. You heard it, but you know what happened?
What?
Somebody here, after the revolution, when the revolution came, there was no music from Cuba was coming here. So they started calling everything salsa. That's why the name is salsa. That's why I don't like it, because salsa don't mean nothing. It's not rhythm that you can say that's a salsa rhythm. They call salsa mambo, guaracha, they call salsa. They call everything salsa.
Any kind of Latin music, they call it salsa.
Any kind of Cuban music.
Cuban music.
Because the other Latin music is completely different.
Oh, okay.
We didn't know nothing in here about all the Latin music until the merengue.
And that's from, merengue is from
from Santo Venice. Domingo.
Oh, that's from Santo Domingo.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
That's the only 2 ballroom music that people dance by. Huh. Cuban music and Dominican music.
Oh, okay. So now, where did tango come from?
Tango from Argentina.
Okay. But that was a crazy long time
ago. Oh, that was big in Europe in the early 30s.
Yeah. Why you don't like Latin jazz term, the term Latin jazz?
Because if you advertise something that I create with a name, I don't think nobody should have the right to come and change the name of that person.
Okay.
What Latin is? What is Latin?
Uh-huh.
We know Latin to begin with.
Uh-huh.
So that I don't see why they do that. They did it with the salsa. They don't. I hate to. They're gonna do it to my music. My music is Afro-Cuban jazz.
Yeah.
And that's what it is.
Afro-Cuban jazz.